Dit is Papa Alpha 0, Echo Tango Echo voor de Daily Minutes met een nieuwsupdate van vandaag 9 december 2015. Dit is het bulletin van woensdag. Vandaag hebben we Contestia met dezelfde instellingen als de afgelopen dagen. Ik heb echter wel iets aan de sterkte van het Contestia-signaal veranderd. Vanwege de grote drukte bij mij moet ik helaas vandaag met de uitzending een beetje improviseren. Vandaag kan dat niet anders dan in het Engels, omdat het hier een erg leuk item betreft. De Rain Reporter publiceerde vorige week een tekst naar aanleiding van een discussie op Packet Radio over repeaters. Let wel, het betreft hier een tekst van 1995. Vertaald luidt de titel Waar zijn toch alle repeaters gebleven? Luister hoe sommige dingen zijn veranderd en sommige andere dingen in de afgelopen 20 jaar precies hetzelfde zijn gebleven. Vanwege het tijdgebrek herhaal ik vandaag ook de mosseoefening van gisteren. Vrijwel zeker heb ik vanaf vrijdag weer gewoon net als altijd weer wat meer tijd. Ik hoop morgen te kunnen improviseren in het Nederlands.
From the friendly confines of Fayetteville, Arkansas, I'm Will Rogers, K5WLR, with this Rain Report, in which we'll endeavor to answer the question posed in 1995 by Stephen Overracker, WA6HAM on Packet. Where have all the repeaters gone? As you listen to Blair Alper, KA9SEQ, read this packet piece from 1995, remember this commentary was written 20 years ago. In many ways, the points Steve makes are just as valid now, all these years later. His thoughts do not necessarily reflect those of anyone affiliated with the Rain Report.
Where have all the repeaters gone? A commentary posted on Packet by Steve, WA6HAM. You key up your VHF or UHF radio and nothing happens. Nothing. Is it your radio? Is it a blown fuse? Or perhaps your antenna? You dial up another repeater frequency and key up again. Nothing again. Everything appears all right with your equipment. The lights are on and the radio's receiver goes whoosh, but there's no friendly kerchunk. So you dial another repeater and try again and again and again. No luck, no kerchunk, no repeater, no nothing. What's going on here? Where's the repeaters? So you want to know, then read on. Many years ago, there was a new area of ham radio that used surplus tube radios and tube analog logic systems. A few enterprising hams would put an AM receiver and transmitter back-to-back with the logic of the day and call this a repeater. A group of people would get together and pool their financial resources to make this repeater thing possible. As with all of mankind's ventures, organizations became necessary and took form as repeater clubs, associations, and for the determined few, privately owned repeaters. The users of this period used crystal-controlled radios and for all practical purposes were rock-bound on their local repeater. The majority of these repeaters were open and required no special equipment to access the repeater. The repeater required a control operator to monitor every facet of the repeater's operation. If the control operator wasn't present, then the repeater was not on the air. Since there was not an overabundance of repeaters, the users would support their local machine with time and money. New hams would find out what the local repeater was and join the group. The atmosphere and attitude of this era was of belonging to and supporting a worthwhile endeavor called a repeater. The 1960s and 70s brought FM repeaters and better equipment to the band. Repeater groups became larger and more numerous. During the late 70s, frequency synthesizers came on the scene, and hams found a new freedom of not being rock-bound to just a couple of channels. Companies began selling repeater packages in the early 80s that used non-commercial radios so that every ham could now have his own repeater. The spectrum became congested, and loyalty to a local repeater by its users began to wane. The congestion of the band led to interference between repeaters on the same frequency and between hams. The saturation of the band with inexperienced repeater operators and the dilution of the technical base further accelerated the chaos of the band. During the latter 80s, repeater groups began using PL to protect their receivers from man-made and adjacent channel interference. This practice masked the problem of hearing the interference and led to users not knowing why they weren't making the repeater. I've heard some repeater operators claim that it was required by the site manager, but you can bet that the site manager was probably sick and tired of hearing about that interference the hams are having from everybody else. The inexperienced repeater operator's motto must be, what you can't hear can't hurt you. There is another group segment that uses PL as a cloaking device to keep the other hams off the repeater. While the repeater operators think that they have excluded these other hams off their channel, the technology does exist for Joe Ham to buy a PL encoder and show up on their local channel after a little work. There are endless variations of both these tactics to reduce the interference of user traffic on repeaters. The end result of these tactics are that Joe Ham has fewer and fewer repeaters available to him now than before. For example, in 1985, the area in which I live had 8 VHF repeaters. Of these 8, 6 repeaters were high-level systems, and only one of these repeaters had PL. 7 years later, only one high-level repeater remained without full-time PL, along with 2 low-level repeaters. The repeater operators who attempt to operate an open non-PL repeater find themselves dealing with a disproportionate number of displaced users. What these repeater operators of the non-PL repeaters also find is that their non-membership usage is increasing, while the membership size of their group remains somewhat constant. It would appear to the casual observer that many of these users feel little, if any, loyalty towards any particular repeater, yet they have little concern about monopolizing someone else's repeater. The repeaters are free, right? Wrong. The most inexpensive repeater is worth $2,000, while the more complex repeater systems are worth tens of thousands of dollars. They require maintenance and upgrading of equipment, and these costs quite often will outpace the membership contribution. The atmosphere and attitude of this era is not of openness, but of how to protect what one has while not belonging to and supporting a worthwhile endeavor called a repeater. I have not taken this journey down memory lane to gripe about the current atmosphere of repeaters, but rather to give a brief view of repeater history so that others may gain a better appreciation of the problems facing these operators and users of repeaters. I have but these suggestions. 1. The repeater operators should strive to provide a state-of-the-art repeater system without the use of PL that is open to all. 2. Users of repeaters have a duty to financially support the repeater that they call their own. Remember, there is no such thing as a free lunch. 3. If you use someone else's repeater and you are not financially supporting its existence, remember, you are a guest and use it sparingly. No one likes daily schedules occurring by non-supporting freeloaders. 4. There are some open repeaters that operate under PL. If you find a repeater in PL, be courteous and inquire if the repeater is open or closed. 5. If you find a closed repeater, respect the wisdom of those who operate it. If after reading the above you find yourself flaming mad, just remember there is plenty of underutilized spectrum out there just waiting for you. Do something constructive and put up your own repeater. You might find it fun and in the process become what you and your friends detest most, your own version of a repeater god. 73 from Steve, WA6HAM at WB6HAM.poundnocal.ca. I'm Blair Alper, KA9SEQ.
So now you may understand better the answer to the question Stephen Overracker, WA6HAM, posed more than 20 years ago. Where have all the repeaters gone? His thoughts do not necessarily reflect those of anyone affiliated with the Rain Report. The reason why so many repeaters have been erected then and now are as flimsy as paper. Hence the nickname for many repeaters today of paper boxes, buddy boxes, and ego boxes. The Rain Report is copyright 1990-2015 Rain. All rights are reserved.